And I'm so proud of you guys. You're my little celebrity army.
Thank you, oh. Mr. President. God bless you.
Kevin.
God bless America.
What did I tell you about making crank calls in my office?
Not to do it.
Not to do it without me. You hungry?
You can judge if your children are mature and intelligent enough to...
Good afternoon. Good afternoon in the Rose Garden. Thank you, Mr. President. Madam Vice President, an honor to be with you and to be with the Majority Leader of the Senate, Chuck Schumer.
Republicans haven't accomplished much, but what they have accomplished has only benefited the wealthy and well-connected. Reminds me of the old Woody Allen scene. Woody's at the diner with someone, and this guy says to him, you know, these portions are small. No, sorry, I got it backwards. the guy says to him, this food is terrible. But Woody said, yeah, but the portions are small.
He said,
well, they haven't, you know, the Republicans haven't accomplished much, but what they've accomplished has benefited the wealthy and well-connected.
I'm going to say something outrageous. I have never been particularly poor at calculating how to get things done in the United States Senate. So the best way to get something done, if you hold near and dear to you that you like to be able to... Anyway. We're ready to get a lot done. And if we have to, if there's complete lockdown and chaos as a consequence of the filibuster, then we'll have to go beyond what I'm talking about. Okay, hang on. Sorry. Oh, sing me. It's Kim.
So thank you, Mr. President, for your confidence.
Well,
thank you.
Thank you for willing to do it. Now we're going to get down to business here, and Ron, who am I turning this over to?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. President. I think it's time for the press, our friends in the press, to leave, though. Thank you.
Is age a legitimate issue?
It is a legitimate issue, sure it is. And I think people are going to judge it. If I were to run, I think they're going to judge me on my vitality. Can I still run up the steps of Air Force Two? Am I still in good shape? Do I have all my faculties? Am I energetic?
I'm just damn some horse.
Little lady. Mother had a way. You got that twinkle too. How you been?
Yeah.
Obama isn't a United States citizen. Where do we stand on that?
I don't know. He's a United States citizen, in my opinion. In fact, the birther thing is a red herring.
What do you mean?
Because I believe Obama was part of the CIA in his early life. Look at his jobs. His job,
community organizer.
Well, his foreign jobs, and check out his mom and what she did. And
what
all
did
this.
She do?
She was just involved in many foreign countries, and the CIA always has front jobs. You know what? Internationally, you know what? One of the big front jobs for the CIA is, because they all have to wear two hats. YMCA.
Really?
Oh yeah.
So you believe the president was born in this country, but he was a CIA operative before becoming the president of the United States?
That's what I believe.
I witnessed my mother's impact as a contractor with organizations like USAID. I was reminded how lucky I was to be an American.
When I heard Indonesians talk about the hundreds of thousands slaughtered in a coup, widely believed to have CIA backing, that it brought a military dictatorship to power, I felt America's defenses weakening. Saw chinks in the armor that I was sure over time made our country less safe. My friends and I sometimes threw around words like fag or gay at each other as casual put-downs, attempts to fortify our masculinity and hide our insecurities. I cared more about my tropical vacation than I did about threats against the homeland.
Once they get into this room,
like four hours at the most. They're already in labor when they get here.
Mm.
How do they get here? Do they come by
donkey cart?
would you let me out that day? I was a good mom.
Oh, they're making food for us, apparently.
Oh.
Well, like, they want us to eat food with them. You're cute, but you're dirty.
The three wives, like, all get along.
Yeah, they all get along. Okay, so whichever wife is doing the cooking that day is the wife that the husband's gonna be sleeping with. Yeah. They were asking about you.
Ah.
What about you guys? What you guys did, what you guys are doing in the image.
Hello, I'm Dumiake Mwakalielie.
And I'm Vincent McCory. This is In Focus.
We begin in Niger, where soldiers have toppled President Mamadou Tanja.
Mutinous soldiers say they've suspended the constitution and dissolved the government.
Tell us, what's the latest you're getting from Niamey?
The latest is the military, they set up a Supreme Council for Restoration of Democracy that happened yesterday. And a few minutes ago, I heard that they lift the curfew they installed, and they are holding discussion to find out what they're going to do on the political part.
Does this give hope that the military will hand over power to civilians very soon, possibly?
We don't know yet.
Niger's new military leaders are briefing their neighbors on plans to return the country to democratic rule.
Diplomats have condemned the coup, but believe that Niger's new military leaders are serious about quickly returning the country to democratic rule.
It's just a few blocks away from the presidential palace. It is confirmed now that at dawn, a military faction did attack the presidential palace and attack the presidential guard.
Fellow Americans.
Right now, the COVID-19 vaccines are available to millions of Americans.
And soon, they will be available to everyone.
The science is clear. These vaccines will protect you and those you love from this dangerous and deadly disease.
They could save your life.
So we urge you to get vaccinated when it's available to you.
That's the first step to ending the pandemic and moving our country forward. It's up to you. It's up to you. It's up to you. It's up to you.
Back and to the left.
It's up to you.
Back and to the left.
It's up to you.
Back and to the left.
It's up to you.
Back and to the left.
The science is clear.
Back and to the left.
Ceremonial first pitches at World Series.
Tonight is an extraordinary evening because we've come together in support of an extraordinary man, Governor Bill Clinton. I am so thrilled to be part of honoring Governor Clinton, and I am doubly thrilled to be tonight's first... either by word or by deed. Because what's done to them, they will do to society. They learn by example. Bigoted parents create bigoted children, who in turn become bigoted parents themselves. But if we educate them properly and give them the love and respect that they deserve, we as a nation will be enriched. They are our future and they are our hope. And we hold tomorrow in our hands when we hold our children in our arms. Careful the things you say, children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn.
Thank you.
is what it means to be the first. And because I know you have a lot of students who are first in their family to go to school, to go to college, first of your gender or your race to perhaps in your neighborhood or in your community to want to pursue a certain kind of life or vocation. And I just want to remind you, 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 and I just want to remind you.
You hungry?
Confidence in the next generation, younger people, who are the age of my children or younger, because they don't carry a lot of the prejudices that older generations may still have about this issue. I know young people think that there's no place for discrimination in our society. I agree with that.
Hey everyone, how's it going? Hey everybody, thanks for joining. Hi everyone. Hi everyone. Hey everybody. Hey everyone. How's it going? Hey everybody. Thanks for joining. Hi everyone. Hi everyone. Hey everybody. Hi everyone. Hi everyone. Hey everybody. Hi everyone. Hey everybody. Hey everyone. How's it going? Hey everybody. Hi everyone.
Do you have any plans to travel to the southern border, sir?
Well, look, I guess I should be flattered. People are coming because I'm the nice guy. That's the reason why it's happening. That I'm a decent man, or however it's phrased. That, you know, that's why they're coming, because no, Biden's a good guy. Truth of the matter is, nothing has changed. And so I'm convinced that we'll be able to stop this, because it is the most pernicious thing. This makes Jim Crow look like Jim Eagle. I mean, this is gigantic.
President Barack Obama said he believed the filibuster was a relic of the Jim Crow era. Do you agree?
Yes.
Why not abolish it if it's a relic of the Jim Crow era?
Successful electoral politics is the art of the possible. Let's figure out how we can get this done and move in the direction of significantly changing the abuse of even the filibuster rule first. It's been abused from the time it came into being by an extreme way in the last 20 years. Let's deal with the abuse first.
You're moving closer to eliminating the filibuster. Is that correct?
I answered your question. The other thing I want to point out to you, and I hope you point out, the vast majority of these children, 70% are 16 years old, 17 years old, and mostly males. Doesn't make it good, bad, or indifferent. But the idea that we have tens of thousands of kids in these god-awful facilities that are really little babies crying all night, there's some, that's true. So I can't guarantee we're going to solve everything, but I can guarantee we can make everything better. We can make it better.
Have you had any talks with Senate Republicans who are threatening this administration with not considering the immigration legislation that was passed in the House until the situation at the border has been resolved?
No, because I know they have to posture for a while. They sort of got to get out of their system. I'm ready to work with any Republican who wants to help solve the problem or make the situation better. But folks, I'm going.
Are you for real? So let's talk about this, because so much of our national conversation, which is not a conversation, about immigration, is driven by people who could not care less about immigrants. Often people want to say, why are you talking about the border crisis? Or why aren't you talking about it in this way? Well, we're talking about it. They just don't like how we're talking about it. Because it's not a border crisis. It's an imperialism crisis. It's a climate crisis. It's a trade crisis. And also, it's a carceral crisis. Because as I have already said, even during this term and this president, our immigration system...
Shut up, bitch!